Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about object-oriented programming, pointer structures, as they occur in object-oriented programming, the notions of a class and that of a method, inheritance, as soon as you have class hierarchies, and the notion of encapsulation. So, let's get started. So we have already seen in the past weeks the notions of imperative and declarative programming. And to quickly recall what it was, declarative programming is all about describing what is the result of a computation, while imperative programming is all about describing how the result is to be obtained. Furthermore, we have seen control-structured programming and functional programming, the concepts thereof at least. And to quickly recall what that was, functional programming is in where function descriptions or functions themselves are first class, and control-structured programming is where the control flow constructs, like the if and the while statements, are first class. So it is all about how you give a description of a program and in what style. In essence, it all boils down to the question of how you can manage the data, and that is actually a representation of the contents of the memory of a computer, and the effects of that data, so how the memory of the computer over time changes. And since these two concepts, that what is, and how what is changes over time are very central in computing, a particular programming style emerged, which is that of object-oriented programming. In object-oriented programming, you can isolate in objects a particular state. So you could think of the state as being a particular region of memory. And that object then intuitively comprises how that piece of memory changes over time while the program is executing. And so you can then understand the memory of a computer as typically its memory space, but now you divide the memory space in all different kinds of objects. And these different objects then are changed over time independently of each other, or at least conceptually. This particular way of programming is useful because it allows you to better get a grasp of otherwise quite complex descriptions. And object-oriented programming can be done in both the functional or in the control-structured style of programming. To sort of some people, I mean, it is obvious that in the memory of a computer, lots of objects reside, whether they are function descriptions or whether they're assembly, assembly code instructions, or whether they're integers. Everything must be somehow stored in the memory of a computer. And that can be manipulated over time. So from that, you could then indeed also arrive at the motto or the slogan, well, everything is an object. And there are some programming languages that really take this as a maxim. So that means, for instance, in the programming language Smalltalk, which is a typical object-oriented programming language, indeed it is the case that everything that you can talk about in the language is considered to be an object. So let's get a bit more concrete so that you get a better picture in your mind of what this object-oriented programming is all about. So for that, let's first consider pointer structures. So as I already explained, you could understand the memory space of a computer as being divided in separate regions. In each region, you could then consider to be the state of an object. And these states of objects could then, maybe independently of each other, be manipulated and change over time. So whenever you take a snapshot of the state of a system, at one instant, then you can understand the memory structure as being divided into these objects. And that is a pointer structure. So pointer structures abstract away the low-level details of the memory space, so you don't talk about addresses per se, so being the point in which you can retrieve low-level values. No, we talk about pointer structures in which the objects, or points, you could then think of to be representing these regions in memory space, and you are not... because it's an abstraction, you're not very much interested in precisely what is encoded in this memory. You only abstractly think of it as some object. You don't care about what is precisely stored in memory that is taken by this object. And furthermore, to define or to understand how objects are related to each other, there is the notion of a field. And a field you can think of as a pointer from one object to another object. So that is depending on the implementation of the programming language, fields are stored within memory and allow you to jump from one object following or dereferencing its field and jump to another object in memory. I'll give a concrete example later of pointer structures. So what can objects be? Well, you can allocate objects, or you could say you could create objects, or you could construct objects. And these words are often used synonymously, but depending on the context, you might want to mean something differently with it. For instance, the allocation of an object is quite a low-level operation, because it reserves some memory in which that object then can be stored, the newly created object that can be stored then. Whenever you create an object, you typically say, okay, I'm initializing the memory contents that were unknown to me whenever it was allocated to a fixed initial state, the initial state of the object. And now you can say an object is fully constructed or is constructed whenever it is also the case that then, for instance, its fields are then set in a proper way. So from the low to the high level, you first have to allocate some memory. Then you create an object by initializing the memory to some fixed default initial state, say. And then you can construct the object by making sure that certain fields are assigned properly. Some values are in place. Now, whenever you have objects, you can also then destruct the objects, destroy them, and deallocate them. And often these terms are also used synonymously, but depending on the context, some programming languages also give a different meaning to these words. So for instance, destructing an object would mean that it would bring the object into a final state. And then destroying an object would mean that it would cause any reference to that object to be annihilated. And then the deallocation of an object means that the memory space that the object takes is then repurposed maybe later, after it's deallocated, for a different use. Okay. And now there are two flavors of object orientation. Let's say that we have, of object creation at least, or the way you deal with the construction and deconstruction of objects. You have the flavor of object orientation where you have to explicitly destruct objects by issuing a delete command. And this is an example of such a language would be C++. And a different flavor would be the implicit destruction of objects. By the means of garbage collection. An example of such a language would be Java. So I'll come back to these explicit and implicit destruction later. Okay, so these are pointer structures. Can we see an example? Sure. So let's say, here's an example. Let's say that the box that you now see represents, abstractly at least, some memory space. Let's call it Eden space. Or at least that's the technical term that's also used, for instance, in the Java virtual machine. And now what do you create in Eden? Well, obviously you create an Adam and an Eve object. You can think of these points as representing in this memory space some fixed amount of space, some memory that is allocated, and then these objects reside in memory. Now, then you can create a third object, let's say game, and now this object, it is currently, as you see it, it's allocated, because it has some place in the space, but it is not yet constructed. Because to construct it properly, you have to set the fields of the game object by pointing its father and its mother to the proper objects, other objects. So now we could say, after this has happened, that C is properly constructed. Afterwards, let's say we have some able object that is created and constructed. So therefore also its fields father and mother are properly set. And now there is maybe the operation of deleting an object. So whenever we delete the object, the reference B points now to some space that is no longer occupied by an object because the object was deleted. So we also have to make sure that we clean out those references, so that the B reference is no longer used and that you not inadvertently point to memory to which no object actually lives. And finally, you could replace able by some other object set. And this just gives you an idea of the creation, the deletion of objects, and that objects you could understand as points in space, abstractly speaking, and that the fields of an object can be understood as outgoing arrows to other objects. And this should be sufficient for understanding most memory contents snapshots you could take whenever you reason about object-oriented programs. Okay, so now that you have a basic idea of what pointer structures are, let's think about how we could program with objects in mind. So you could maybe create a programming language in which, hey, you can allocate and construct objects, allocate, create, and construct objects. You could maybe include some mechanisms for destructing and destroying and deallocating objects. Okay, but then often you will see that some objects share certain properties or certain fields. And in that case, it is useful to group all the objects which have these certain commonalities into what is called a class. So what our purpose here is to structure programs so that it becomes easier to work with objects. So these classes, or classes of objects, you could think of themselves to consist of, well, a name, the name of the class, and a list of field declarations and a list of method declarations. So the field declarations of the class, they describe what every object of such a class has as fields, so that you then know if, as soon as I have an object of a certain class, then I know it must also have a field. And then typically these fields are given field names. But moreover, as I told in the beginning, objects not only are useful for representing a snapshot, but also to understand how the memory changes over time. And these changes can be affected by calling, as it is called, methods on objects. And the methods that are called on objects can also be declared in a class. So you could think of a method as in the simplest way you could think of a method as just being a function declaration. So it's a procedure with input parameters and output parameters. But furthermore, there is an implicit this input parameter. And that is the subject, that is the object on which the method is called. And so every method is always executed in the context of this object. So whenever you manipulate the contents of an object, you are always know what object you're talking about. That's the this object. Furthermore, there is a special kind of method, which is called the constructor. The constructor does not return anything. Instead, the constructor is a method that is implicitly called after you create an object of a class. So you could think of you create an object, you make sure that all the fields have some initial default value, and then you call the special constructor method on that object, and that constructor then has as a purpose to set up properly its fields to the proper values and to create the pointers between objects in the right way. Okay, so now that we have classes and methods, we can then now also think of typing. Typing in the sense of that we are able to understand the program text, whether we have not made a mistake in the program text by means of type checking. For that we introduce then the reference type. And the reference type, you can think of it as for every class that you introduce, there is a corresponding reference type. And that reference, the values of such a reference type, you can think of as all the references or pointers to the objects of that class. Now, there is in every reference type a special null value, which is called the null pointer. And it is basically the absence of an object. So if you don't point anywhere, so suppose, for instance, the Adam and Eve objects in Eden space, they themselves did not have a father and mother. So you could think of those fields to be set to the special null value. And this is some default value that indicates that you're not pointing to an object. So here you see an example class definition, class declaration, namely the class with the name person. It declares, so here's the name of the class that you declare, and then it declares at this position the fields, so the field father and the field mother, both of reference type person. And now here you see the special constructor method that's indicated because the method has the same name as the class that you declare here. It lacks indeed a return type, because there is no return type in the case of a constructor. But constructors do take input parameters, namely the implicit this parameter, you don't write that down, and then the two explicit parameters f and m. And now in the body of the constructor, the this object, which was implicitly passed as an input, the field father of the this object is now assigned to get the reference to f, and the mother field of the this object is assigned the reference m. Furthermore, we declare here a method. So there is the method with the name kill. It has as a return type void, and it takes one implicit parameter, the this parameter, and one explicit parameter, this person p. And the body of the kill method, it first prints some string, and then it deletes its argument. So now you could, to understand how we have created Eden space in the previous slide, we could construct A, we could construct E, and then we construct C by saying new and then the name of the class and supplying in this case A and E as actual parameters. And then we could construct B, and then we could say that C kills B, and then we set B, the reference B, to null. And finally we construct S. Now note that in the case of explicit destruction, you have to explicitly say when an object is deleted. So that is, for instance, this command delete P over here. But the moment you have explicit deletion of objects, or explicit destruction of objects, it is the case that there could be still a reference to the memory that occupied the object. So it is always necessary after deleting an object to make sure that no reference points to that old object, and that you clear out these references. Now, in an implicit In the case where you have an implicit destruction flavor of object-oriented programming, you cannot do delete. It is not possible to do this deletion of objects. And instead, you can only make sure that an object is deleted by forgetting about it. And by that I mean by clearing out all references to an object, the object becomes garbage, and then a garbage collection process can then clean it up. Okay, so now that you have seen a class, let's talk about class hierarchies, because you can structure classes in such a way, namely, that you can declare a class to have a superclass. And then this means that the class you declare inherits from its superclass the fields and the methods. But this is a useful way of structuring your program. Because you don't always have to give them the same field declarations and method declarations. It's a way of writing down your program in a neat, short way. But furthermore, there is a special feature whenever you do inheritance, namely a subclass, so that's a class which declares a superclass, can override the methods that it inherited from its superclass. And I'll shortly give you an example of why this is useful. But why would you want to do this? Well, it basically allows you to refine the behavior of a class into a particular subclass that has slightly different behavior. Because let's say that the superclass declares a function which you have some expectation of, then the subclass could do just something different. And now The nice thing is that whenever you see a reference type, it is always the case that it could refer to that class, the class that the reference type belongs to, or any of its subclasses. So that means that if you refer to an object from a class, you don't necessarily know whether that is an object specifically of that class, or whether it is an object that belongs to one of its subclasses. Now, whenever you call a method on a class, there is this mechanism called dynamic dispatch, because you do not know statically from looking at the program text if you, for instance, are supplied as an input parameter something of a reference type, you do not know what is the actual implementation of a method until runtime. And you cannot statically know it, or not in all cases you can statically know what is the method body corresponding to a method call. Now, this dynamic dispatch is a nice mechanism that allows to that is used to implement this overriding of methods, so that whenever you call a method on an object, that the most specific and refined behavior that was declared in the subclass is then performed. Furthermore, every object. We are talking about objects here, and maybe even your motto is everything is an object. But you could then understand that this class hierarchy, that it must be exist, there must exist some notion of the root of this hierarchy. The class which is the superclass of every other class. Well, and that is the class object. Typically it's called object. Well, it depends on the programming language. And so in Java, you have that indeed there is this root of a hierarchy, which is called object. But in different object-oriented programming languages, this is not the case. But let's assume for simplicity here that we do indeed have a root in our hierarchy, in our class hierarchy, which is the object. Okay, so an example of inheritance is, well, let's consider a class of animals. The animals are, so it declares the class of animals, which have as a field the booleans, whether they are alive or not. Then we have the constructor for animal, which sets the field alive to be true. And whenever you poke an element, it will print some string, which represents that the animal is making some sound. Now, there is a particular subclass of animals, which are persons. And persons extend animals. Hè? So the declaration of the class person is an extension of the class animal. So that means that every person has also the fields that every animal has. So every person also can be alive or not. Furthermore, whenever a person is constructed, so here you see the constructor of a person, it must also be the case that first the superclass has to be constructed. And that is indicated by this over here. And so then, whenever you construct the superclass, well, then you know, well, the person then is alive. And then there are no further things to specify in the method body of the, or in the constructor body of the person. Now, furthermore, this is the same method as that was declared by animals. So this is an example of an overridden method. Yeah, this has the same name, it has the same signature, it is overridden. So that now means, and I can give you an example here concretely, that if you create a new person and you store it in a variable of reference type X, and now you store that reference to that object you just created in a variable of reference type animal, which is a superclass of person, so this assignment is allowed by the type checker of the object-oriented programming language. Now, if we invoke the poke method on the animal, we still know it was this object was this person. The fact that we consider every person to be an animal does not change that whenever you poke that animal, which in this case is a person, the right method is invoked. So in this case, whenever we perform the y.poke call, we make use of the dynamic dispatch mechanism that is in the implementation of this programming language that looks up what is the actual runtime class of this animal, so it could be a subclass of animal itself or animal itself, and then for the most specific subclass associated to the runtime instance of this object instance, we then look at that corresponding class and invoke the overridden method, in this case body, in this case poke. So then what will happen, it will not print this noise that the animal makes. No, persons make a more civilized response whenever you poke them. So they say hey, and they become annoyed. So this is not the original behavior that was present in the class as it was declared here by animal. No, the person class refines the behavior of its superclass and now does something else. Okay, so that is a very simple example that shows inheritance. Let's continue. There is this principle that is very useful whenever you want to design yourself a class hierarchy. Because how do you now decide, is the animal on top or is the person on top? And actually, it's quite a fascinating question. Eh? What is the distinction between an animal and a person? Well, some people say different things. I believe persons can get addicted and animals not. And there is something with long-term planning, but whatever. Anyway, you have some domain of discourse, things that you want to talk about or problems that you want to solve. And now you have to digitize your domain, your problem domain. And to do that in an object-oriented fashion, it is sometimes useful to design a class hierarchy. But how would you properly choose the order? Well, in the case of animal and person, it is clear every person is an animal, but not every animal is a person. I mean, my cat, although I don't have a cat, but suppose I have a cat, I cannot talk to my cat and expect a reasonable answer. A person is a person if it's a reasonable person. Well, you could also say, of course, that a person is still a person if they're not reasonable. For instance, if I sleep, I'm not reasonable, but then I'm still a person. Anyway. Let's not get into the philosophical, because that's a big problem, that you get in a philosophical debate of what is what and how should your ontology or your how could you structure it properly and how could you talk about it in the right way. Well, this is obviously a nice philosophical problem, but let's keep it technical here. how to design a class hierarchy. Well, there is a principle, it's called the Liskov substitution principle, and you could understand a nice way of forming this hierarchy is by understanding what reference types are intended to be subtypes of other reference types. And what do I mean by a subtype? Well, this is what Barbara Liskov defined as follows. Let's say we have S and T to be reference types. Then we can say that S is a subtype of T precisely whenever for an arbitrary property that is true for any object of type T. So we have a property that is true for any object of type T. Well, then that property must also be true for any object of its for any object of its subtype. So this gives you at least a more objective way of understanding, okay, how should I put classes in a hierarchy, right? So then this depends on what properties have to be true with respect to subtypes. If you say I have something that is a subtype of something else, so if S is a subtype of T, then if there is a property that is true for every object of type T, well, that property must also be true for every object of type S. Let me give you a concrete example to make it a bit more understandable. Let's say we have a shape. And a shape is a class, it does not declare any fields, but it does declare two methods, namely one method to retrieve the width of the shape and another method to retrieve the height of a shape. Let's say it's a two-dimensional shape, for this is something that you would want to show on a computer screen. Okay, and now there are two particular shapes that I could imagine, namely we have a square obviously is a shape, and we have a rectangle, and the rectangle is also obviously a shape. So now the question, whenever you're designing a class hierarchy, would be, well, a square is a shape and a rectangle is a shape, but is a square a rectangle or is a rectangle a square? So how could you then properly answer that question? Well, in the first instance, quite naively, you would say, well, square, you only need one field, namely the length of one side. And then that's both its width and its height. And then we can create a subclass of square, namely the rectangle, where we inherit the size of one side and we add an additional field for the other side, the side that is orthogonal to it. So could we do that? Well, you could do that. But then because it is a subclass, you also automatically get, that's the way that the subclassing mechanism works, that then rectangle becomes a subtype of square as well. And maybe this is not what you want. Because whenever rectangle would be a subtype of square, then this property should hold. This meta property talking about properties should hold. So take for this property phi of x to be the property that x, the width of x and the height of x are equal. And this is a property that is true of square, because squares have the same width and height. But it is a property not necessarily true for rectangles. So now, if you ask yourself the question, if we have made our class hierarchy just as sketched, so you have shape and then the square extends shape by adding a field for one side, and then rectangle extends square by adding another field for its other side, is it then a proper class hierarchy? Well, then you have to answer the question, can rectangle be a subtype of square? Well, suppose that rectangle is a subtype of square, well, then we expect the Liskov substitution property to hold. So that means if we have a property that is true of square, then that property of every square, then we also expect that property to hold for the rectangle. But now the property that is true for every square is that its width and height are equal. But this is not a property that is true for every rectangle. There exist rectangles for which this property is false. So no, rectangle is not should not be a subtype of square. So that's also the reason why rectangle should not inherit from square. Instead, you should have that square inherits from shape, and separately that rectangle should inherit from shape. But you could also ask yourself the question in the reverse. Is it possible that square is a subtype of rectangle? Well, in that case, you should ask yourself, is it the case that every property that is true for rectangles, is that property also true for squares? And I'll let you think about that question. Okay, so let's continue. An important concept in object-oriented programming languages is the notion of encapsulation. Because we just saw very shortly reasoning about properties of objects. For instance, does this object have width and height that are equal, and does that object have width and height that are equal? And you could formulate properties of objects. Properties are, if you look at an object at a particular time, is that property true or false at that time? But you could also think of sort of higher properties about objects. For instance, properties like, if you perform these and these and these method calls, then such and such and such result is expected. So the properties you could formulate about objects are quite interesting themselves. So now suppose that we have a nice class hierarchy, we have designed it properly so that this list of substitution properties principle hold of it. Then how can we now guarantee that the intended properties that we intend that objects have are indeed preserved? Well, for that there are a number of interesting concepts that most object-oriented programming languages also make use of. So first of all, let me talk about the notion of invariance. So whenever I have a property that is true at an instant of an object, so it's a property about the state of an object, say, then you call that property invariant whenever that property is true over the whole lifetime of an object. And a lifetime of an object is after construction, its lifetime starts, and before destruction, its lifetime is then the object dies, so to say. A property that holds over the whole lifetime of an object is called an invariant property. How can we make sure that these invariant properties are indeed invariant? So that if you imagine a property to be invariant, that this cannot be violated in any way. For instance, squares, for example, you have you could say squares, their width and height are always the same. That is an invariant property of squares. Whatever you do to manipulate your square, you could move it around on your screen, or you could enlarge it, or you could rotate it. Its width and its height, the two sides of the square, always remain to be the same. Now, to ensure that, it is nice if not everybody in random positions in the rest of the program could change the memory that is underlying the object. So this is called encapsulation of the state of the object. It is not, if a programming language allows you to safeguard the state that underlies an object, then you can reason about invariant properties entirely from understanding the class declaration. And it's not that any other thing in the program, any other command in the program could hiddenly or secretly manipulate the internal state of an object, as it is called. The fields of an object can only be mutated by the methods of its own class. Then we can understand that the object is properly encapsulated. It's a nice design principle. Furthermore, there is this notion of nesting. So you could have a class, and then the class declaration itself, within the class declaration, there is another class declaration. Well, then the inner class, the class declaration that is nested deeply, is contained within an outer class. That's the class declaration that appears outset of it. And now this allows you, whenever you have methods of this nested inner class, to also manipulate and access the fields of the outer class. And this allows very nice design patterns. And I'll show you an example in the next slide. This is called nesting. And a consequence of having nested class declarations is the notion of sub-objects. Sub-objects are objects which have implicitly a notion of ownership. So that means that their sub-objects are owned by objects of the outer class. And so whenever you have an inner class, a class declaration within a class declaration, you could understand every object created of the inner class to be a subject, sub-object of an object of the outer class. Okay, let me give you a concrete example. Let's say here we have a cell, a memory cell. And the cell has as a field a value, an integer value. Now, whenever you construct the cell, you can supply as an input parameter the initial value of the cell. So then the constructor, when it's executed, it assigns the value to become the initial value. So that's written over here. And now, whenever you have the cell, there are two methods. There is the reader method and there is the writer method. And the reader method will return you a new subobject. And here you see it's a subobject because we say we construct a reader, but the reader is a subobject of this object. And this is the implicit this object that is passed into this method. So in the context of a cell, we could construct a subobject, which is a reader to this cell. And now the reader itself is a class, it's an inner class, which has the method read. And so the read method, whenever it's called, you expect a return value of type int, which is then returned by the body of the read method to be the value of the implicit owner of this subobject. So whenever we construct the reader subobject, there is an owner, and the owner is an object of the class cell. So we can access the value of the outer class. We can access the field of the outer class of the owner object. So the nice thing here with this cell is, suppose you construct a cell and now you want to pass off only read access to a separate part of the program, well, then you call the reader method and you obtain a subobject. And the subobject reader can only read from the cell. It cannot write to the cell. Oppositely, we also have the writer, and the writer also creates, whenever the writer method is invoked, it returns a new writer subobject that's written here. Now, the writer subobject also can access by modifying the value field of the outer class of the owner. And the owner in this case is the owner of the subobject of the outer class. So this owner value, it refers to this field over here, can be modified by the writer subobject. So whenever you have a cell and you want some piece of the program only to write some value to yourself, but not be able to read its value that is stored in it, you could pass it the writer. Now, obviously, this only holds whenever in the programming language that you use, for instance, to implement this, there is the proper encapsulation. So that means that other programs cannot directly access this value field. And for that, you can make use of memory protection. So that this value field cannot be accessed by the rest of the program, except through a reader subobject or a writer subobject. Now, and this, having the access to these nested classes and being able to write some memory cell like this allows you to reason in a better way about object-oriented programs. Well, this is what I wanted to say about object orientation in this first video. Thank you for watching and see you later.